I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. In the midst of his children, the Lord said he would be. It doesn't take very many. It can be just two or three. And I feel the same sweet spirit that I felt all times before. I can say that I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. The hem of his garment, and I can almost see his face, and my heart is overflowing with the fullness of his joy. I can say without a doubt that I've been with.
Good morning, everyone. On this Labor Day weekend, and today celebrating the blessing of our backpacks. I even brought mine, so I can join in. Never done this before, but I think we'll get through it all right. So, Saturday, September 7, 9 to 2, Pauling UMC tag sale. Many wonderful items to choose from, rain or shine, in the fellowship hall. Anything we want to add to that?
Grace and I are here all day Wednesday, as usual. So if anybody has more donations to bring, Wednesday would be a good time. We'll be setting up that day.
I got a corner cabinet about that high, small windows in it. And...
for you, Pastor, yes.
Okay.
The marketplace.
Also, there is the opportunity to Lake Champlain Men's Weekend Retreat, September 19 through 22. I don't know if we have a handout here, but the information is, the phone number and all that is in here. There's also the Women's Bible Study will reconvene on the 9th.
Next Monday. It's off for tomorrow, but reconvene next Monday.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Any other announcements? I trust not. Let us call to worship. Welcome, beloved of God, for truly you are deeply, wonderfully, and beautifully loved by God of all creation.
Come, let us worship God who loves us.
Whether your week was filled with mountain high joys or valley lows, sorrows, peace like a gently flowing river, or stress like a stormy gale, this is the time to rise and come away to worship God, who sustains and tends to you.
Come, let us worship God, who loves us and tends to us.
In a world that pulls us this way and that, God's love is our true north, guiding us with uncommon wisdom through all that life brings.
Come, let us worship God, who loves us and guides us.
Beloved, the time for singing has come, because God's love, care, and wisdom sustain and guide us wherever we go.
Come,
let us worship and sing to God,
who loves us and
guides and sustains us. Amen. To God be the glory is our opening hymn, number 98 in the hymnal.
Save and open the light.
I just have to pose for a minute and tell you about Fanny Crosby, who wrote this hymn. And she came from around this area. She wrote many, many, many hymns. And that's one of them. But the interesting thing about that is she was blind. And from 6 years old. And yet she knew that God loved her. And even though she was unable to see, it was an accident by a doctor treating her eyes, and she lost her vision. But yet she sings in blessed assurance, you know, seeing the Spirit from above, you know, and she talks about singing about seeing. Well, she's seeing in another way, in a spiritual way. And I just admire her for that. So let us pray this opening prayer. Creating God, you are the source of nature's splendor, the beauty and fragrance of delicate flowers, and the sweet sound of birdsong. We come to you this morning with delight and gladness, grateful for all of your wonders. As the fields produce their harvest, may your love grow within us. We too may produce a harvest of love, hope, and joy. Amen.
Today's Old Testament readings are from the Song of Solomon, second book, verses 8 through 13, and from Psalms 45, verses 1 and 2 and 6 and 9. The voice of my beloved, look, he comes, leaping upon the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look there, he stands behind our wall, gazing in at the windows, looking through the lattice. My beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. For now the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth. The time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree puts forth its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. My heart overflows with a goodly theme. I address my verses to the king. My tongue is like the pen of a ready scribe. You are the most handsome of men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has blessed you forever. Your throne, O God, endures forever and ever. Your royal scepter is a scepter of equity. Your love, righteousness, and hate, wickedness. Therefore, God, your God has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. Your robes are all fragrant with myrrh and aloes and cassia. From ivory palaces, stringed instruments make you glad. Daughters of kings are among your ladies of honor. At your right hand stands the queen in gold of Ophir.
The epistle lesson is James chapter 1, verses 17 to 27. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave birth to us by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved brothers and sisters. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for human anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those that look themselves in the mirror. For they look at themselves and on going away, immediately forget what they are like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers but who forgot, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world.
Just a closer walk with thee, the faith we sing. Gospel for today. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it there, and also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups and pots and bronze kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and the scribes ask him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. As it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There's nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within the human heart that evil intentions come: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, debauchery, envy, slander, pride, and folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O God, you who created all that there is, you are behind the mystery of creation, including the heavens above. And you sent Jesus into the world to be with us, to teach us, show us the way, the truth, and the life. So now we ask for a little help from your Holy Spirit, that the words that we have been singing and praying may come alive in the spirit that is within us and the spirit that comes to teach us, to correct us. And as I speak, may my words and thoughts be worthy of your holy word. Amen. So this is Labor Day weekend. And it wasn't until this morning that I thought, oh, it's Labor Day weekend. You know, because we get caught up in our traditional ways. On holidays, we have cookouts, gathered at Christmas. We gather around the table, and there, at least in Christmas, I hope we have our mind fixed on the baby Jesus, but even there, we go overboard with silliness, you know, having to buy gifts and Christmas cards and all that, and you feel like a real slug if you don't follow through with bearing gifts and all the cards. and stuff like that. So I've been down at the racetrack in Lime Rock since Friday. And we have a car there. This is the seventh year in a row that we're running the same car we campaigned back in 1978. And it's still a beautiful, clean, magnificent car, driven by the best driver I've ever known, my brother-in-law, Rick Bell. And he can still drive. He's 70 years old, and he does well. So all that is about the car, you know, and racing and meeting people we haven't seen since last year, catching up on the news and that kind of thing. Also, there's children getting ready to go back to school. And that's why we're going to bless these backpacks. When I was a kid, we didn't have backpacks. I don't know what we did. I stacked books under my arms. I can remember in the ninth grade, I was going to Middletown High. And a Middletown is kind of a tiny or a small down-to-earth city. And the kids there were city dwellers. And they had their own ways. And about 20 of us came from Marlboro in the country. And the kids in Middletown High thought we smelled bad because we were all farmers. And, you know, they used to tease us. And we had a couple of guys going to trade school. And back then, and I don't know if even now, trade school is associated with someone who can't make it on a college level, which is a bunch of, well, you know. So here I am carrying my books. I was like a 100-pound weakling at that time. And I was open for all kinds of abuse. So I'm coming up the stairs, going to my next class. And this kid with his red hair spotted me and he punched the books out of my hands. And they all went flipping down the stairs, papers, everything. So the next time I saw him coming down the stairs, I was prepared. My mother taught me this when I was about 7 years old. Don't let him get away with that. I saw him coming down the stairs and I got a hold of his sleeve and sent him on his way. That isn't how Jesus would do it. You know, but so we have children going back to school and we suffered through a period with COVID that did great harm to our ability to reach our children with learning. And besides that, schools are getting smaller population, not as many children. So we need to give our schools, our teachers, our kids, all the support we can come up with. And that's part of why we're going to celebrate the blessing of the backpacks. And like I said, I brought my own. But Labor Day, I was thinking of my dad. Back long time ago, he said he worked on the Empire State Building, 80th floor. And you know how those guys, they get so used to being up there, it doesn't bother them at all. They sit and have lunch on a beam, you know, and chat about whatever, you know, how's the wife and all this. And he also worked on the Whitestone Bridge. And but then the Depression came. And being they were living in Brooklyn and New York City, there were food lines, bread lines, much like we have today. We're still not feeding the people and giving them jobs. You know, he lost his job with the Depression, and times were really difficult. I remember my mother telling me that she got some kind of condition in her hands because of malnutrition. So some things change and some things we have to be reminded of about that change. As a laborer, I think my first serious job was cleaning the bilges on the Tidewater, a destroyer tender ship. And I was down in the engine room where I belong. You know, I'm a mechanic. And in later years, I built race engines and everything. But cleaning the bilges, I tell you, you don't want to go there. It was hot. We were in Norfolk on a hot summer, and it was just terrible. But we have to honor everyone who works, who, of course, they want to earn a living, but they need to be honored just because they do work, and some of them, or most of them, maybe do work that we wouldn't want to be engaged in. The Bible tells us how to treat a laborer in Deuteronomy, I believe. It instructs the bosses and the owners of companies to pay the workers at the end of the day. So they worked day to day and got their pay. And if they didn't, God promised something and it wasn't good. And there would be retribution. So here we are in the when I read this Psalm of Solomon, I wondered, what are they up to? Where is it now? Oh, here. Song of Solomon? No. What's that got to do with Labor Day or the gospel story? And I read it a number of times. And the theme for today is song, singing, which we do every Sunday. We sing. I just love to sing, and I love the hymns we just sang. And so that's what this is. It's a song, just what it says. I love this part. And I think it talks about me. My beloved is like a gazelle, a young stag. Those days are long over. But I thought about my grandson who has a girlfriend. And I'm sure he's right there with that gazelle thing. And I've noticed over some months now, she's the leader of the pack. And, you know, Asif goes along almost on every occasion. She has an idea. They went up to Lake George this weekend, and they're having a great time, but he wasn't so sure about going. But one thing I noticed between the two of them is devotion. They serve one another. And time and again, my grandson will be preparing something. And I said, what you making? Oh, this is for her, my girlfriend. And, so there's romance, even in the Bible. And my beloved speaks, say to me, arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. Wow. Run away, huh? But how many times did you want to do that when you were like 18 years old? So, and it speaks also about the beauty of the earth. Now the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. Flowers appear on the earth. The time for singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. Well, I don't know about turtle doves, but I'm into blue jays. And this time of year, especially, I listen for that first blue jay. And it's telling me it's time to go back to school. I don't know why that is. Has anyone had that experience with blue jays? No.
In the winter.
So I have here a little blue feather. This came from a blue jay. I'm saying that. I don't know anything about it. But, and I connect that with, ever since my wife died, going on 5 years next week, I noticed as I was taking walks in the forest, I'd look down and there'd be a feather. Some of them really big, like from the buzzards, and others really small, like the one I just picked up. I have about probably 60 feathers I've picked up. And every time I say, thank you, Diane, you know, I figure that's her telling me she's watching down. And that's just my idea, you know. It's how I honor her, her presence in my life and her leadership in my life. And I remember in the last days, she'd be in bed upstairs and she'd send me a text. I need some crackers and cheese. And I'd run down and prepare a plate of crackers and cheese, up and down, water, this, that, up and down the stairs. And one night she apologized for having me run back and forth. And I said to her, it's the only thing I can do to help you. I love doing this. It was a joy running up and down those stairs and putting a little something. She knew I couldn't cook, you know. So she wanted a snack. It's that kind of thing that I think the Song of Solomon is singing about. Your throne, O God, endures forever and ever. Your royal scepter is a scepter of equity. You love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. So, in the gospel, we're talking about people being religious for religious sake, not for God's sake so much. Want to be right? Sometimes you want to be an authority, you know. And one of my first appointments was up in Fairfax, Vermont. And one day I got a phone call from a young couple who had a child, and they wanted to have that child baptized. And I found out when they came to meet with me that the pastor of their church, another community away, wouldn't baptize the child because the parents were not married. And I thought about that as, where in the Bible do I see not to baptize children from parents who aren't married? The young father, working hard, spent 3-4 days in Hartford every week learning how to build and repair diesel engines for trucks. That's an excellent occupation. Here, he's reaching out to learn, to make a difference. And the mother stayed at home with the child, waiting for weekends, and they would go to church. And I thought about it. I said, I have no problem. Let's baptize this child, you know? And these are the kind of rules that we get torqued up about sometimes, and they have no validity. Jesus talks about what comes in other words, what you eat doesn't defile. It's what comes out of you in a negative way that can defile. And I remember the scene where was it Peter? Yeah. He was on the rooftop and he had this vision and this blanket comes down. This is high noon. And it's full of all animals that Jews don't eat. They're unclean. And God invited him to come and eat. And Peter said, no way. This is all unclean food. And God says, don't call something unclean that I call clean. So God is the one who grants righteousness and grace and helps us to live in a freedom of not being held down by rules that are insignificant. So we're going to be celebrating communion in a little bit. And just want you to remember why Jesus came to this earth, to show us the truth and the way. His disciples were quite a gang. They didn't get it even to the end. But God loved them so much. He could see the beauty in each one of them, even those who made mistakes, who did wrong things. God sees what is good. And he sent Jesus to show us the way, the truth, and the life. But also, his compassion for his brothers and sisters. And going to the cross was for you and me. He took it on. He took on the condemnation that comes from the world. All the arguments, all the wars, Jesus died for that. And while he was on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." Wasn't he right? When we hurt somebody, even unintentional, we don't know what we're doing. And coming here together, we together admit that. But we celebrate nonetheless because of song, because of God's grace, who wants us to be part of his kingdom, K-I-N-D-O-M. Kingdom, that means family. And so as we continue to celebrate, I don't know if you're having a cookout tomorrow or what, or today, just remember the children, remember those who labor, remember to be kind to one another, especially inside the family and in your neighborhood. Amen. Hosanna, loud Hosanna. James, the writer, acknowledged that faith is the most important thing in your life. But if there's no action to back it up, he said it's worthless. You can have faith, but if you're not willing to respond in like manner as God does with us, he doesn't want to hear about it, you know? And I thought, how does this church, how does this parish respond to the faith that we have within us? And once again, I thought about Cook's Night Out. And we only see a little portion of what is really going on. You know, the kitchen crew works from morning to night with love and care, preparing 70 to 90 meals to be delivered by people who may not come to any church. But they found it in their hearts to go out of the way and sacrifice a little bit and do some good. That would make James happy. It makes God happy. And we don't see the ripple effect either. So faith is a lot about what you don't see, what you can't see. But you respond in love and a like manner. And I'm so happy and thankful. I sit down with people here in this building, sometimes 20 in all. And they're having a great time sharing a meal, sharing the story of their lives. And it's just a wonderful thing. And I thank God for everyone who participates. And also those who receive on the receiving end, what are they feeling, you know, and blessed? And I don't know them from that end, you know, but I trust because of what these churches are doing, it is a job well done. I thank God for that. Wow, I didn't mean to preach another sermon, but I thought it would be important to open our eyes and see what's really happening in people's lives. Let us pray. Oh, Father, Father of your Son, Jesus, whom you sent into the world to show us the way, the truth, and the life. Especially this time of year in this place, we see the lushness of flowers and weeds and trees and animals. We know it all comes from you. And even us two-legged come from you. And you bless us in extraordinary ways. But all is not well in our neighborhoods, even in our homes, our communities. People going to war, continuing to hate instead of love. But with you, you give us the strength and the courage to follow in your way. We pray for all the victims of war, for all the victims of lack of nutrition completely and illnesses that we have no adequate vaccine or drug supply. But we especially pray for those in our families. And Isaiah wrote what God instructed, said, even be kind to those in your household. And don't use your own excuse for not helping out there. Because God prefers that you're kind and loving to one another. So here we are, preparing to go to school with the kids, teachers, administrators, celebrating Labor Day, remembering and blessing all those who work. So we leave all these our concerns and our joys with you. We pray this prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Greetings.
Hi, everybody out there in Zoom.
We're here. Greetification.
Give me a wave. You hear me? May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with
there
you.
Be peace on earth. Do 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 do.
Gifts that you may take them into your care, turn them into action of generosity,
love of labor. Amen.
Blessing of the backpacks. I've never done this before, so we'll have to work together. We have a couple of students with us, and I brought my own, so I'm asking you to come forward. We have a little prayer.
They'll be on the screen also.
They'll be on the screen. Good.
Do you have a backpack?
Oh. It's in my mom's shop.
Oh. Here. This is a surrogate. Come on up. Going into seventh grade.
Oh.
Wow. Really getting there. 10th grade. Well, here we are. And this backpack will stand for the backpack that you go to school with. You use one too? When I was a kid, well, like I said before, we didn't have backpacks. But these come in so handy. All of your stuff, your supplies, and all that. We're going to place this up here. Asking God to bless your experience at school with all the other kids. And now let us I guess I'm the leader. It says today we have before us backpacks to be carried to and from school by the children and youth gathered here. These backpacks will contain work to be done, work that's been returned, books to be studied, tools to complete homework, notebooks, pencil, pens, protractors, compasses, crayons, rules, scissors, glue sticks, and other items used for schoolwork will find their way in and out of these backpacks. Some days, so much stuff will fill these backpacks that the student may find it difficult to walk. Other days, they will be light and nearly empty. But on each and every day, these backpacks represent work required of the students gathered here. And as in every aspect of our life, we bring these before God for blessing. At this time, let us pray together now. Gracious God, we lift to you today these students. They stand here ready to receive your blessings,
and they commit themselves to study and learning in school year ahead.
We ask your blessing on each of them. We ask that you protect your children from all kinds of harm, and help them to know that they go to school each day surrounded by your steadfast and unconditional love. Further, we ask your blessings on these backpacks. They will hold the schoolwork of each student and will be carried from home to school and back again. As these students carry these backpacks, may they be reminded of the love and care of this congregation who surrounds them each school day. We pray as well for the teachers and administrators in our schools. May they also be sustained by your blessing. May they be reminded that this congregation embraces their call to teaching and learning, and surrounds them with love and care as well. We pray in the name of Jesus, who seek to follow day by day. Amen. All right. Well, we've come to that place in our worship where we do celebrate that evening when Jesus was with his disciples for the last time. And he gave them something to remember him by. He gave them bread, symbolizing his brokenness, blood, his sacrifice for you and me and the whole human race. So now let us pray prayer of confession. Continue, O Lord, to extend your grace and mercy to us, your unworthy servants. We fail you because you depended on us to be your witnesses. We were too embarrassed to testify about your faithfulness. We were too busy to speak a word in your name. We are neither anxious nor ready to sit. Reflect deeply on Holy Scriptures. Good Lord, extend your grace and mercy as we ask your forgiveness in order to receive your forgiveness. We know that we need to forgive everyone who has offended us. Help us to hold nothing against anyone that will jeopardize our gift of forgiveness from you. To live fully in you and to love. We pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Creator God, you revealed to us your creation on earth. The waters flowed and the winds blew. You set the cosmos into motion and created living beings. You gave life to the plants and the sea creatures and the land animals. You put into flight the birds and insects, and you made people to walk on the ground. You blessed us all and called us good. But when our love failed, we turned away. You revealed a love for your people and all of creation that never ends. And so we praise you with all the company of saints and sinners, singing your unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy God, power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You continue to reveal your love for us in your Son, Jesus, who came to live among us and move as a human on this earth. When he dined with his friends just before he was to be executed, he reminded them of your love revealed in the gifts of bread and juice before them on the table. He took the bread in his hands, gave thanks to you, broke it, and shared it with his friends, saying the familiar words, Take eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks for it and shared it with all who gathered, reminding them, drink this, all of you. This is the cup of my covenant with you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Together we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. Still creating spirit, be poured out on those gathered here and on these gifts from the field in bread and juice. As we receive them into our bodies, make us your body. Unite us with those who have come before us in your kingdom and with those who will come after us, now and always. Amen. All is prepared, and I invite you to come forward and receive. Let us sing, lift every voice and sing. Sending forth. Beloved, may God bless you with the uncommon wisdom to know deep in your hearts the vastness of God's love for you. And in that knowing, may God's love bubble up and overflow from your heart into the world around you. Amen. Good to see you.
Good to see you. See you in a few minutes in person.
God bless you all. Have a wonderful week. Have a safe Labor Day.
Yes. Yes, please.